For those that don't know me, I'm Tash. I'm one of the members here, and I'm going to be taking you through the service this evening. I'm determined to start on time, so I'm going to go for it, regardless of how many people we've got. So have a seat. And we're going to get started with some sung worship. So whether you feel confident sitting or standing, however you want to worship the Lord, we're going to hand over to the band and get cracking.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. Why don't we stand so we can sing together and worship the Lord together?
Faithful.
saints.
And all the saints and angels bow before your throne. All the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God.
You're worthy of it all.
You're worthy of it all. You're worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
All the same.
You're worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
Yes, Lord, we just praise you, Lord, for you are worthy of our praise. You are worthy of our worship because of what you have done for us, because you have given us your Son, Jesus. He suffered and died for us in our place so that we can be forgiven. And for that, you are worthy, Lord, of praise and worship. And we do give you thanks and praise your holy name.
Yeah, Father, I thank you that you are so good and that we have such a great example in you and that we can trust in you and put all of our faith in you, Lord. And I just pray that, you would just teach us more about who you are this evening and just help us to be open to what you want to say to us, Lord. Amen. Have a seat. I'm going to just run through some things that are happening in Wycliffe, some things that are coming up. I know it's everyone's favourite part of the service, so try and stay with me. It's actually shorter than usual, you'll be glad to hear. So first of all, if you are not part of a house group or a life group, and that is something that you'd really love to do, we really want to encourage people to get involved and do life together. It's a really great thing to get stuck into. If that is you and you would like to, come and chat to me or Graham and we can point you in the right direction and get you sorted with someone to join. Also, if you are not a member but you are a regular attender and it's something that you've been thinking about or praying about and you want to take that next step in becoming a member, do speak to Paul or Ruth or one of the other team and they can have that discussion with you. Coming up, we have Sell Out, which is like a youth event for those who are involved in sales during the week. Yes, that's what we like, bit of enthusiasm. It's really great. If you're a young person and you haven't signed up yet, go and sign up. If you want some more information about what's happening and when it is and all of that kind of stuff, Pete is your man to speak to. He's got his hand up. We would love to see you there. We are running a course on the Bible, marriage and sexuality, a seminar, on the 22nd of October from 9:30 to 1 in the upper back hall. So this is a repetition of the seminars that were happening over summer. So if you didn't manage to get to one of those and you would really like to join, please do. Make an effort to be there, as I believe this is the last one. Living Out is a course coming up that's run by same-sex attracted Christians, sharing how to live with same-sex attraction in a God-honouring way. And it's like across Reading. It will be on the 12th of November, 9:30 till 1 here at Wycliffe. For more info, it'll be on the Wycliffe Weekly, or grab a member of the team and I'm sure they can pass on some information. On your chairs, you might have seen a flyer for the superhero party. That's something we love to get involved in at Wycliffe. It is on the 31st of October for children aged between 3 and 11. Entry is £3. If you want to come along, bring some people. If you want to get involved, though, I'm sure either Pete or Paul or Ruth can like point you in the right direction of someone of where you can go. So there's like loads of activities going on. So there's like some fun sweeper thing that you have to jump around. I'm sure like loads of youth love being part of that. I was told the other day, and just like lots of fun events. Whether that's helping with refreshments, helping with fun games like that, then I'm sure you'd be more than welcome to join. And finally, if you are like new to Wycliffe or have been coming for ages and you don't get the Wycliffe Weekly, but you would like to hear more information about what goes on in Wycliffe, please do sign up to that. There is a link on here that you can do, or grab someone if you don't know how to sign up and we can get that arranged for you. And that just tells you what's going on in the week and what's coming up, and just really helpful because you'll get all of those notices that you can read in your own time. And when you've instantly forgotten them when you leave this room, you can have a look. Also, if you're a new person and you haven't been to Wycliffe before, but you and you don't have any communications and we don't know who you are, it would be great to know who you are. And we have some connect cards at the back at the welcome desk. So please do fill one of those in and we can get in contact with you and you can kind of find out a bit more about what we do here. That'd be really great. The guys at the back are just going to come around with the offering, so do pass that around, and I'm going to just let them do that. And I'm just going to explain what we're going to do next. I just thought it'd be really good to just pray for everything that's going on in the world at the moment. There are 100 things that we could be praying about, I'm sure, and I'm not going to do it justice by listing things, but just a few things we could be praying about. We could pray about the situation in Iran. We can pray for Ukraine and Russia. Our government and all sorts of things that are going on with like the cost of living and coming up to winter, and just those in our community, those on our hearts, those who are unwell. So I just thought it'd be really great if we can either just pray with the people around you, or if you don't feel comfortable with that, you can just pray on your own, or maybe write some stuff down, or whatever works for you. But we're just going to have a few minutes of just praying together. So feel free to move your chairs around a little bit, and I'll just leave you to that. But we're just going to continue taking the offering.
Thank you.
Yeah, Father, I just want to bring all these prayers to you. I thank you that you are a good God who loves us so, so much, Lord, and that you know each and every single person in this world and you love them so deeply, Lord. And I just, pray that your peace, your comfort, just your presence would be with all those who are struggling at the moment and all those who need your wisdom, Lord, that you would just guide us in our everyday lives, whether we're in positions of power and we have a lot of influence or whether we're just going about our normal daily life, Lord, that you would just be at the center of that, Father, and just giving us wisdom in the best ways to go about our day, Lord. Amen. I'm now going to hand over to Aaron, and I'm just going to quickly pray for him as he comes up, and he's going to do our sermon this evening. Father, I thank you for Aaron. I thank you for the preparations he's put in for this evening, Lord, and I just pray that you would use him powerfully to speak to us about whatever it is that you want us to take home from here, Lord, and that anything that's not of you that will just fall by the wayside, Lord, but that you would just change our hearts this evening and help us to be ready and open to what it is that you have to say. Amen.
Oh, man. Hello. It's good to be with you this evening. And I hope that if you are new here at Wycliffe or this is the first time that you've come, I hope you feel welcome. If this is your first time at Wycliffe or if we've never met, please do come and say hello. It'd be nice to meet you. Yeah, you are very welcome here. So today we will be talking and looking at the lives of Priscilla and Aquila as we continue in our series in the unsung heroes of the Bible. In general, they are not mentioned all that much, Priscilla and Aquila. They are mentioned a total of 6 times over 4 different books. And the vast majority of what we find out about them is in Acts chapter 18, which we'll look at a little bit more today. But the rest of the times when we hear about Priscilla and Aquila, they go something along these lines. As we can see in Romans chapter 16, verse 3, Paul says, "Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ." And that's pretty much it for most of the times. So we see these two people in this long list of names at the end of, you know, many of Paul's letters, as he says, you know, greet these people as they do the Lord's work in lots of different places. And so we don't have a whole lot on their lives. We find out lots more about the lives of other people. But nevertheless, they really do give us a lot that we can reflect on and learn from what is mentioned. I wanted to start by telling you what this sermon isn't about, which is odd, but I think it will be good to know that there's lots that we can think about, but there's only a few bits that we can cover in the time we have. So if you do some research on Priscilla and Aquila, you will often come across some great teaching about God-centered biblical marriage. And how that can really bless and impact others in really wonderful ways. And I don't disagree with that statement at all. But when I was reading about Priscilla and Aquila, I didn't feel like that was the root of what God wanted us to hear about today. And if you are looking for some wisdom on that, in whatever stage of life you're in, can I direct you to... Oh, trust me not to be able to use the clicker. Is it on? Yes. Oh, that is not the part. Oh, sad times. Can I direct you to a wonderful book written by Tim Keller called The Meaning of Marriage? And it speaks to those who are exploring marriage, to those who are married, to those who are currently single, to those who may be called to a lifetime of singleness, and sort of digs really deep into how marriage and also singleness can be used to really glorify God in our lives. So if you are looking for that, sort of some wisdom on that, look at that book. It's fantastic. And although Priscilla and Aquila were a married couple, I think their example in their Christian walk actually reaches a lot broader and a lot wider into society that can be picked up by the young or the old, for those of us who may be in school or uni or at work or who have been retired, to those people who might be moving around a little bit more, like geographically at the moment, or to someone who has been stable geographically for a long time. And I truly believe that their example is something that all of us can take something from. The other thing that this isn't a sermon about is this is not a sermon about the idea that, or the topic of food, okay, and eating. Although the idea of a meal is, and that sort of biblical topic of eating and sharing food together with everyone and other people is really central. And again, another book that is fantastic is called Ordinary Miracles, a wonderful book about a church pastor who set up a church around a table, basically. Fantastic book, which is great. It makes me sound like I've read a lot, doesn't it? Before I was 19 years old, the only book I had read was Fantastic Mr. Fox, and when I was 8 years old, and my parents had to really force me to do it, and I wrote a paragraph book review in year 2 or whatever it was. And since then, I hadn't read till I was 19, and then I picked up a book. So it's never too late. Read a book. It's good. It is good. I didn't even read my GCSE texts, not all of them. I just read the important bits. But read your texts, everyone. That's important. It's really important. Right, so thankfully our wonderful welcome team have given out some Bibles today, and we're going to dive into our passage. It is in Acts chapter 18. Fantastic news. It's in Acts chapter 18, and I'm going to take us through it a little bit because we're going to dive in and out of it. But if you are using one of the church Bibles, it's page 1114, 1114. And I'll give you a moment to find it if you want it. Get it up on your phones, do all those things. So, we're going to start in chapter 18, verse 1. It says this. After this, Paul left Athens and went to Corinth. There he met a Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus, who had recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla. Because Claudius had ordered all Jews to leave Rome. Paul went to see them, and because he was a tent maker as they were, he stayed and worked with them. Every Sabbath, he reasoned in the synagogue, trying to persuade Jews and Greeks. And then we hear a little bit about Paul's experience in Corinth, which wasn't exactly the easiest time. We hear of lots of oppression from many of the Jewish people there. And Paul, in his letter to the Corinthians himself, says actually that he came to Corinth with great weakness and in great weakness and with fear and trembling. And so Paul didn't have the easiest time there in Corinth. But we pick up we're in Acts 18, verse 18, It says, Paul stayed on in Corinth for some time, presumably with Priscilla and Aquila. And then he left the brothers and sisters and sailed for Syria, accompanied by Priscilla and Aquila. Before he sailed, he had his hair cut off at Cenchreae because of a vow he had taken. They arrived in Ephesus, where Paul left Priscilla and Aquila. He himself went into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. And while Paul was reasoning with the Jews and traveling to Galatia and Phrygia, we pick up with what Priscilla and Aquila have been up to in verse 24. It then says, meanwhile, a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexandria, came to Ephesus. He was a learned man with a thorough knowledge of the scriptures. He had been instructed in the way of the Lord and spoke with great fervor and taught about Jesus accurately, though he only knew the baptism of John. And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. When Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they invited him to their home and explained to him the way of God more adequately. When Apollos wanted to go to Achaia, the brothers and sisters encouraged him and wrote to the disciples there to welcome him. When he arrived, he was a great help to those who by grace had believed, for he vigorously refuted his Jewish opponents in public debate, proving from the scriptures that Jesus was the Messiah. Now, the first thing that I'd like to touch on is that Priscilla and Aquila are really, really great witnesses to the power and joy that is spread by good Christian hospitality. In today's reading, we see two very different people, Paul and Apollos, who are at different stages of their walks with God, and both of them were welcomed into Priscilla and Aquila's house. To me, this shows hospitality that truly emulates the heart and the spirit of Christ. And I think it's important that we take a look at how Jesus showed hospitality. Now, when we think of hospitality in our society now, what often springs to mind is, welcoming someone into a nice, warm, hopefully, house and giving them some dinner and a hot drink and some pudding or something like that, right? And that's all very nice. And we show good hospitality. And that is good and true as well. But what we see from Jesus is not necessarily different, but deeper. And it's important to remember as well that Jesus didn't have a house. He didn't have a permanent kitchen. He sometimes didn't even actually have any food when he was being hospitable. And when I was thinking about what example I wanted to think about, I was drawn to Mark chapter 6, where Jesus feeds the 5,000 people. And it says that Jesus was teaching this large crowd and when his disciples sort of reminded him that they were in a remote place so that they should send the people away to go and get some food. And Jesus starts by telling the disciples, well, no, you go and feed them. And the disciples say, well, no, we can't do that because it would cost half a year's wage. And so Jesus really importantly rejects all of the social constructs about hierarchy and who should sit where and who should sit next to who, and just gets people to sit down in big groups of 50, and with just 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, he fed everyone with plenty to spare. And when we look at the sort of the driving force of this fantastic miracle, we find it just before this miracle happens. It says, when Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. In that very short moment, when Jesus pulled up his boat, he seemed to see the deepest need within every single one of us before we had met Christ. We are comparable in that moment to sheep without a shepherd. We think about the fact that without Christ, we all have been wandering the earth, sort of seeking safety and security and identity and things that can't really satisfy us. We wander around thinking, well, we'll start with good grades, right? Good grades will give us some kind of security. And then we realize that whether we get good grades or not good grades, we still feel this sort of sense of angst about what is next and what's going to happen. And so we hope that we'll get a good apprenticeship or we'll go to a uni or get a job that is offers us some form of security. And we realize, well, even when we get to uni, then you're like, well I still haven't quite got this sense of security about life or what's going on. And so then maybe, we hope that our job, or we look for security in something like money or clothes or how we look or the people that we interact with. And even that we realize, well, we still don't feel this sense of security. I still have this sort of odd hole in my heart or life that I haven't really been able to fill with whatever it is in the world around us. And Jesus sort of sees us scrambling around in the world, searching for security, and he has compassion on us. This compassion is not something that Jesus feels just once. We see it over and over again. Right, in Matthew 14, it says that he had compassion on them and healed their sick. In Matthew 15, Jesus said that I have compassion on the crowd because they have been with me now 3 days and have had nothing to eat. In Luke 7, where Jesus meets a widow whose son has died, it says that he had compassion on her and said to her, "Do not weep." And this Greek word that's used for compassion here is the same in all these instances. It isn't just a surface level sympathy. This is love and mercy which flows from deep within the bowels of a person. This is that compassion that makes your stomach turn and your heart ache for other people. This is compassion that Jesus has for us, the lost sheep. Richard Sibes describes it this way. He says, "When Christ saw the people in misery, his bowels yearned within him. The works of grace and mercy in Christ, they come from his bowels first. And therefore, whatever Christ did, he did out of love and grace and mercy, and he did inwardly from his very heart." What I'm trying to say here is that Christ's compassion on all of us didn't come from a sense of duty or merely to show face. Christ's compassion flowed from the very center of his being and came from his very core because he shares the heart and the spirit and essence of God. You see, when I look at Jesus and how he makes us feel truly, truly welcome, he sees our need and meets us there where we are. Jesus knew that his reason for coming to earth wasn't merely just to be a good moral teacher, although he is the perfect moral teacher. He came to earth to heal the broken and to welcome the lost. Jesus' deepest hospitality came in reminding us, really, that the Father God in heaven who created each and every one of us has a house that has plenty of room and a space and a place for each of us where we will no longer be searching for acceptance or validation because we will be there in perfect unity with our Creator God in the fullness of that creation. And if you haven't been told of our loving and merciful Father, there is good news. In your searching and searching for acceptance and love, God knows you and loves you and has prepared a place there in heaven for you because he has known you and he has loved you for all of time. And he welcomes you with open arms. And his welcome isn't superficial. He yearns to welcome us with compassion from his heart by sending Jesus here into this world to die for each of us so that we can be seen as pure, even after many, many years of searching and scrambling in other places. The hospitality of God shown in Christ really is good news. It's news that offers rest from the constant searching for approval. It's news which offers great security when we think of mere earthly things. It's news which calls our aching soul to rest in the sure hope that we have a Father who loves us, not because of anything that we have done, but because of who he is. You are so welcome at the Lord's table. In Psalm 23, which we sung through earlier, we hear that the Lord is our shepherd, and in his loving arms, we are not left wanting anything. And as we walk through the psalm, which reminds us of the deepest soul-nourishing rest which comes through the Lord, we are told that he prepares a table for us, and he anoints our head with oil, and our cup, it overflows. Now, in Old Testament Hebrew culture, if you were invited to somebody's house, you would know that you are welcome at their house continually, because they would top up your drink and your cup would be full. And so you'd know this is a sort of social construct. Oh, I'm still welcome here, right? And when that person then stops filling up your cup, it's that kind of like sort of, you know, subtle nod to like, yeah, maybe we should go now. Like, you know, he stopped filling up my cup. But when you're sat at the table of the Lord, your cup isn't just refilled. It's not even just full. It is overflowing, because you are always welcome. This is the true heart of hospitality, which is perfectly shown by God. We're always welcome at his table to eat and drink and laugh and cry and speak about what is stressful and difficult and emotive and upsetting. We can come and unload our burdens and lighten the load with the Lord, who always makes us welcome. And as we turn back to our passage and we think about Priscilla and Aquila, we know that after their second move in location, they moved from Rome and then they moved with Paul, they see this passionate, fiery young man, Apollos, and they welcomed him in. And it says that Apollos had a thorough knowledge of the scripture, even though he only knew about the baptism of John. And from this, we might assume that he understood John's teaching that that John baptized with water for repentance, but there was one after him who will come baptizing in the Holy Spirit and in fire. Now, can you imagine that moment when Apollos' eyes were open and his heart was filled full to the brim when Priscilla and Aquila explained to him that this person who John was talking about, who John said that he couldn't hold his sandals because he was not worthy, that person was Jesus. And he lived, and he lives, and he loves you now. What a joyful, joyful moment. And earlier in the passage, we see Priscilla and Aquila, even after they have been exiled from Rome by the Emperor Claudius during this huge sort of anti-Semitic rage, having to move their whole life to somewhere new, taking in the Apostle Paul and offering him work and shelter and friendship and encouragement, maybe even challenge, and laughter, and probably wrestling in thought, and a listening ear, and a shoulder to cry on, and maybe that timely reminder that God still loves you, and that this whole big mess is in his hands. Wouldn't it have been amazing to listen in maybe to their conversations as they were making and mending tents? Priscilla and Aquila were two people who moved to lots of different places in the world. And every time, even though they moved, they knew that their true home, their soul's calling, where their heart found deep, deep rest, wasn't here on earth, but was in heaven with God. And every person who stepped foot into their house, they seemed to create and make this warm window into heaven as they welcomed and cared for other people. And in that care for others, I'm sure that many would have felt that warm embrace of the loving Father and were encouraged in their Christian walk. And so where does that leave us? That leaves us not as tent makers, but as students and employees and members of this general society who are called by Christ to open that small window into heaven for somebody else. Whether that's on the bus or at work, or at your home, or in school, or in the canteen, or at a club. We all have the Spirit of the living God living within us who have accepted Christ as Lord. And all then have that ability to open that small window into heaven and love others and remind them of just how much God loves them. And let's pray as the band come up to lead us in some more song worship. Lord, thank you for the example of Priscilla and Aquila. And thank you for how much you really love us. And I pray for all of us, Lord, that we would create a space where people's cups overflow out of an overflow of your love for them. Amen.
Stand and respond in worship to this with a song.
Oh, come to the altar. shelter. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
Well, who feel like they're so far away, they don't feel welcome at God's table anymore. But as we've just been singing, God's arms are open wide and he loves you so much and he wants you to come back and just, be with him. And he loves you so much, he just wants to... he's got his arms wide open. And if you are one of those people and you're struggling with that and you want to chat to people, if you grab someone that you know well and you trust, pray with them there. Or there's a few people with either lanyards or maybe some of the staff or those people that are part of the 6 p.m. team will just be part at the back and just be around. And then if you want to pray, head to the back, and I'm sure someone would be so up for doing that, or you can come to the front if you want to chat to one of us. But please don't leave without having that conversation if that is you. And we're just going to continue worshipping for a bit longer.
No wisdom.
Your sacrifice for us. We're so thankful, Lord, that you were willing to just bear it all on the cross for us. And through that we have forgiveness. And because we are now forgiven of our sins, we are and have been set free by your power, we now have joy. And joy in abundance. And we do pray, Lord, that we will live out this joy this week. We pray that any of the burdens that are keeping us from joy are released. We are released from those and we are lifted. And I pray that our joy will overflow in abundance. And that people will see that joy and receive it through us, Lord. So that we can share the joy that you've given us with those around us that don't know of your joy. And that they be drawn to you. And want that joy for themselves. That's what you've called us to do, Lord. When you sent us out into the nations, you called us to share the joy that we received through the Gospels. And we need your help to do that, Lord. And we need your strength. And most of all, we need just that joy that comes through the Gospel so we can share it with others. So I pray as we go into this week, you will grant us that joy. So you can share it. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And that's the end of our service. Do stay around and get to know one another and stay for refreshments. But thank you for joining us.